All right, so today's video is brought to you by Undeniable, full color evidence of Black Israelites in the Bible. If you're tired of arguing with people about the evidence, show them the images. Now you can grab this book on barnesandnoble.com and amazon.com. There is a link pinned to the comments section along with all the links to the sources. Make sure you click the link in the comments section so you make sure you get the right book. All right, so now we're going to look at Deuteronomy 28 again. Now, for those of you who have seen my Beyond Deuteronomy 28 series, press 1. If you have not had the chance to watch my Beyond Deuteronomy 28 series, press 2. If you haven't seen it, make sure you go check it out. There's a playlist for it. All the videos are in the playlist. It's, I believe you can click playlist on the homepage of this channel, and then you can find the Beyond Deuteronomy 28 playlist and check out the videos in this series. I get deeper into all that stuff. So I'm not going to focus heavily on Deuteronomy 28 right now, but I do want to read these verses. Deuteronomy 28, verses 45 through 48. All right. So here we go. Moreover, all these curses shall come upon thee and shall pursue thee and overtake thee till thou be destroyed, because thou hearkenest not unto the voice of the Lord thy God to keep his commandments and his statutes, which he commanded thee. And they shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder, and upon thy seed forever. Because thou servest not the Lord thy God with joyfulness and with gladness of heart for the abundance of all things. Therefore shall thou serve thine enemies, which the Lord shall send against thee, in hunger and in thirst and in nakedness and in want of all things. And he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck until he have destroyed thee. The Lord shall bring a nation against thee from far, from the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle flieth, a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand, a nation of fierce countenance, which shall not regard the person of the old, nor show favor to the young. And he shall eat the fruit of thy cattle and the fruit of thy land until thou be destroyed, which also shall not leave thee either corn, wine, or oil, or the increase of thy kind, or flocks of thy sheep, until he have destroyed thee. So I read down to verse 51. That's Deuteronomy 28, verses 46 through 51. So there are blessings and curses in Deuteronomy 28. Those of you who saw the series know this. Those of you who didn't see the series probably still know this because you've read it. So you have the blessings and the curses. The blessings are verses 1 through 14. The curses are chapter 15 through the end. Verse 15 through the end. So now, as part of these curses, there's going to be a nation brought against Israel. Israel's going to be scattered into all nations. They're going to go into slavery. And we get to the history part. Those of you who say you experienced your awakening before 2015, press 1. If you experienced your awakening after 2015, press a 2. I would be a hard 2. So what we experienced in 2015 is a lot of people started digging into the Bible. People had dreams. Myself, I came to it through the history. There were people who came to this knowledge through different means, starting about 2015 and onward were the majority. There were people before 2015, but the majority that we know of, this happened after 2015. And so we almost immediately encountered opposition from people who call themselves Christians, people who claim to be about the truth. Many people were slandered in the process. They made up lies about people. And this particular group who called themselves the Urban Apologists, they came in the spirit of the Inquisition. And so no matter what sources you bring out, it's never enough. It doesn't matter what your personal history is. If you have black skin, this racist hate group called the Urban Apologists, they will say, no, you can't possibly be Israel. You're sub-Saharan African. You're West African. They originally said there was absolutely no proof. Basically, we were delusional, making it up. There's no proof for Jews in West Africa. lo and behold, the Inquisition is full of tons of sources about them putting Jews into West Africa. So it turns out these people who call themselves Christians, the urban apologists specifically, some other people who weren't associated with the urban apologists, or didn't identify as urban apologists, but associated with them, they lied. Not once did they apologize to their congregation. They didn't apologize to us or anybody else about the lie that there were no Jews in West Africa. And it's hard to read any Inquisition information and not come upon the information that Jews were sent to Sao Tome and other parts of West Africa and parts of Northern Africa. So then as time goes by, they changed the narrative to that the Jews sent down there were white Jews and they mixed with black women. And so they created these mulatto children. And then as more information started to come out, all the sources say that the Portuguese Jews are dark, black, even Negro. So there are sources that describe what these people looked like. We also know from this study or this series that the Portuguese had what at the time looked like a half black population. We saw it in the painting, the King's Fountain. And then we read the source that said it looked like a checkerboard with half black population. And then the only event where a mass group of people were moved out of Portugal were the black Portuguese or the Negro Portuguese. And now Portugal no longer has a half black population. So these people, when they were pushed out of Portugal, well, France first, then Spain, then Portugal, down into Northern Africa, Morocco, they were kicked out of Mali. They ended up in West Africa and all along the West African coast. This is all during the Inquisition, which overlaps the transatlantic slave trade. Now, what we're getting into today, these people, the urban apologists who came in the spirit of the Inquisition, they wanted to claim that there were no slaves on board the slave ships. And then the more information came out, then suddenly they changed their position that, well, maybe a minority of those people were slaves on the slave ships, or Jews on the slave ships. I don't know why I said no slaves on the slave ships. They said that there were no Jews on the slave ships, and if there were, they were a minority of the people on the slave ships. Then, as time went by, it progressed into if Jews were on the slave ships, they were hitchhiking on the slave ships. They weren't actual slaves. So now we get to the part where once again the urban apologists will have to move their goalpost, because they've been making this claim is that there were no Jews on the slave ships. Why didn't they get off the slave ships practicing Judaism? And from other studies, we know that they targeted children. I got some more sources coming talking about them specifically targeting children, because it's easier to deal with the children. We know this is going to be easier to deal with a child than it is a grown man. So we have sources that talk about them specifically targeting the children for slavery. We know that during the Inquisition, the children were targeted. They stripped children away. There's some stuff I was going to read, but I didn't want to distract from it. But it gets into the details about children being stripped away and being given to other families to raise them. And it goes into detail, like crazy amounts of detail. So maybe possibly in a different video as an addendum to the series, I might go ahead and read some of those sources. Those are not for the week. I'll say it that way. All right. So we're going to build upon this one section of the Cambridge University Press document that I always bring up, Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge or Politics versus Religion, written by Ulysses S. Santa Maria, published by Cambridge University in 1987. This is in the European Journal of Sociology, Archives Europeans de Sociologie. I'm not going to try to butcher all that, but many of you are familiar with this. I talk about it all the time because there's just so much stuff in here. And Cambridge University has a ton of information on this topic. And so there is this portion right here that I'm going to read. And we're going to focus on this statement. Because even though this was published a long time ago, there are still people who will tell you, well, there's no proof that these Israelites ever ended up on any slave ships as slaves. But today we're going to see that not only were Jews or Israelites, I'm going to use this term interchangeably right now, Jews referring to the kingdom of Judah or the kingdom of Judah as a whole, and then Israelites referring to the same people. I'm using them interchangeably. If you have a problem with that, change the channel, whatever. It's YouTube. It's a billion other channels you can watch. Now, when we get to, no, let me not get ahead of myself. I have to, let me just start reading. So I'm going to read this part here, and then I'm going to point out where we're going to focus on for the rest of this video. It says the study of customs and rights. This page 235, by the way. The study of customs and rights and the analysis of the semantics of these African tribes have led many of their observers to propose some hypotheses and even to draw some conclusions. Dr. Alan H. Gobbi reached the following conclusion. These factors have a very specific significance if we consider the presence of Judaism among the American Negroes. Hundreds of thousands of slaves were transported to America from West Africa during the trade, which started some 400 years ago. What traces of Judaism still remained among the Negroes of West Africa at that period? To the extent that they were persecuted, they were more likely than other Negroes to be seized during wars and sold as slaves. It is virtually certain that many part Jewish Negroes were among those sent as slaves to America. How many of them would have been able to conserve some Jewish customs is another question. This conclusion put forward by Gobbi, which argues for the existence of a more or less recurrent Judaism in West Africa in the same places as those from which the Negroes were taken, is shared by others such as Maurice Delafosse, but most significantly, it has been adopted by a class of educated Black Americans as a key argument to demonstrate that the Jewish religion is the traditional religion of Africans brought in slavery to the American continent. So clearly there was something that led Ulysses Santa Maria to conclude that not only were there Negro Jews on board those slave ships, but they were more likely than other Negroes to be seized in wars and sold as slaves. What war? We know about the one in 1724 where the homie comes down and conquers Ardra. We know in 1727 they come down and conquer Whydah. We know that Whydah disappears off the map. We know that the people of Whydah disappear from the area. We know that all the Black Jews disappear from the area. And here we have a book published in 1987 saying these people were more likely to be seized in wars and sold as slaves. It's virtually certain that they brought Judaism over here. But that's not what we're told when we're given Black History and Black History Month. We watch all these movies, slave TV shows. We have Black history taught in schools, colleges, wherever. And we're not told that Judaism was the religion that our ancestors came over here with. Because that will start to raise some questions. Wait a minute. Why were they practicing Judaism in West Africa? And then you start to look into how did they get to West Africa if they're supposed to be in Israel? Which leads us to Nebuchadnezzar, which we talked about, and Nebuchadnezzar sending the tribes of Judah, Levi, Benjamin, and possibly Simeon into Iberia, aka Spain and Portugal. And then Portugal putting them into West Africa. So we see the migration of the tribes, 3 to 4 tribes, right there, all the way from Israel, all the way to Iberia, all the way back around to West Africa. But we're not told that part of history. Why is it that we're not told that part of history?